this talk is called Defending the Amazon, Defending Life, and we're just going to have Moira Devine is going to introduce Fabio for about five minutes, and then Fabio will speak and Pepe will translate for about 20, and then we're going to take contributions, questions from the floor for a while after that. So, and during the Q&A, Barry will be passing around some of these feedback sheets. Do you want to go ahead?
Okay. Hola, everybody. I'm Myra Devine, political activist, also trade unionist, along with the nurses. I'm not sure what nurses can do for Colombia, but we're there and in about and kind of sneaking under the radar of the nurses' organisations. It's the INNO and the more militant PNA, which is I'm a member of. So, it's my pleasure today to introduce Pablo Andreas to me. Anyhow, he's from the Regional Front of Social Organisations, which include Fatima Y in Colombia. They're a network of over 50 peasant indigenous workers, women and youth associations formed during a heartbreaking, I think, 2014 3-month civic strike against the exploitation of oil, the cocoa fumigation and the progressive displacement of small peasants from the territory. It's a community-led association and to develop different sorts of agrarian projects for their communities to survive from the onslaught of what we see now as big, massive conglomerate capitalism. I suppose defending the Amazon, defending life, defending Earth, the late 19th century, just a small bit of history, it's been closely linked to constant extractive economy. It was the rubber boom, gold, leather, wood, now it's oil extracting in a transnational capitalist form. And it's accelerated, unfortunately, with the free trade agreements, including shamefully one signed in the EU and ratified in the Dáil just January gone. First from the ethnocide committed against the indigenous people who were subjected to extermination, rubber barons, the same crime is repeated against the people and all living creatures in our planet. This bountiful, beautiful Amazon rainforest that we dream of is a vital pillar for the whole planet and source of life for Earth. The struggle of the peasants, indigenous communities in defence of water, food sovereignty and for the right to live their lives as dignity is mirrored in the current struggles we have in Ireland against fracking, against our water tax, supposed water tax, and against TTIP, which is quite scary legislation coming in. An exchange of ideas and a stronger solidarity between the people, north and south, is a key in order for the people to win. I suppose then is os presento, excuse my Espanol, os presento campanares Andrés Andrés Sacananbayu, hombre sindicat muy fuerte para su país, para sindicat y para todos la comunidad. Gracias.
Buenas tardes, compañeros, compañeras, hermanos, amigos y camaradas, reciban un fraternal y combativo saludo desde el sur de la Amazonía, desde la puerta de entrada a esa Amazonía extensa, Putumayo, Colombia.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters, comrades all. Receive a very fraternal and combative greetings from the Putumayo, from the entry point to the Amazon.
Bien, primero, feliz de estar acá. Agradecerles por su asistencia. Venimos de alguna otra forma a agradecer una lucha que ustedes han venido llevando a cabo acá en defensa, digamos, de una agresión brutal en contra de nuestro pueblo, que es la firma de los tratados de libre comercio. ¿Vos me dices?
Sí, tú me dices. Yes. So, the first thing I want to say is that I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy to be here because you have been already part of a struggle of the support to our own struggle, which was the opposition and the campaign that took place in Ireland against the signing of the free trade agreement between the EU and Colombia. That represents a brutal offensive against the rights of our people and our communities.
Bien. Quizá muchos de ustedes saben, y sin embargo, en Colombia, a pesar de que hacen toda una propaganda en Europa, lo que llama el gobierno nacional lobbies, para mostrarle al mundo de que en Colombia se respetan los derechos, de que en Colombia todo pasa sin ninguna, digamos, todo es normal. De hecho, están alimentando una propaganda que dice que somos el país más feliz del mundo.
This is a most difficult struggle because we have a very powerful lobby in Europe from the Colombian government trying to show that in Colombia there's a full democracy with respect of all rights, that it's a very civilized form of democracy, and we actually have got as a latest propaganda device an index that puts Colombia as the happiest country in the world, whether you believe it or not. No, well, it's everywhere.
Bien, sin embargo, la arremetida sigue en contra de todo el pueblo colombiano. No solo la agudización del conflicto político, económico, social y armado, sino también en contra de movimientos u organizaciones que van surgiendo al calor de la lucha. Y voy a centrarme un poco en lo que hoy significa la lucha por la vida, es decir, por defender el ambiente natural, por defender la Amazonía.
But the reality in Colombia is very different. We have an ongoing political, social, economic, and armed conflict, and a key element of this. Yeah, and a key element of this has been the brutal attack against alternatives that have emerged during the struggle of the people. And I'm going to concentrate on our own struggle, which is a struggle for the defense of life and for the defense of the environment.
Bien. Putumayo es un departamento que queda, como lo dije al comienzo, al sur de Colombia. Es un departamento muy rico. Contamos con tres climas, digamos con una variedad de climas, por ubicarnos en el centro, digamos, del Ecuador. De hecho, contamos con países vecinos, limitamos con Ecuador, Perú y con los departamentos de Caquetá, Nariño y Cauca.
So, we have a very rich environment. We are positioned just at the very center of the Ecuador, and we're just bordering with Perú, with Ecuador to the south, and we also are borders with other regions in the north, with Guaviare, Caquetá, Nariño, Cauca, which are from the Orinoco and plains and from the Andean region. We are in the Amazon, so it's a very biodiverse and very rich area.
Nuestra riqueza no es solo la natural, es también la riqueza cultural. Existen 14 pueblos originarios en todo el departamento distribuidos. La lucha que venimos llevando desde las organizaciones sociales ha sido difícil, pero sigue firme porque la historia nos llama a defender la vida, hoy más que nunca.
So, when we say that it's a very rich region, we not only mean in material terms or in natural terms, we also mean in cultural terms. In Putumayo we have 14 indigenous peoples, each one of them with their own language, and even though this struggle is very hard, it's very tough on us, we are compelled to keep on this struggle because we are ultimately defending life.
Bien. Más del 70% del territorio nuestro ha sido entregado al capital transnacional. Petroleras, en su gran mayoría de Canadá. Gran Tierra es la que más hace presencia. Hay otras de Venezuela como Vetra. Bueno, y 12, entre todas son entre 14 transnacionales que saquean el petróleo.
So, in our region, 70% of the territory has been given on concession to transnational capital, specifically to oil extractive companies, in particular to, mostly to Canadian capital. They have a local company called Gran Tierra, which is owned by Canadian capital, and also by Venezuelan capital as well. There's a company called Petra, and they are as well interested in Putumayo.
Bien. Estas petroleras, a más de atentar contra la madre tierra, atentar contra la vida, también atentan contra nosotros, porque financian sicarios, asesinos, para amedrantar, amenazar y en muchos casos asesinar compañeros y compañeras que hacemos resistencia.
These multinationals not only attack the environment, but they also attack us because we have our own resistance. So usually the way it happens is that these companies hire paid assassins to kill and gun down comrades that participate in this resistance process.
Todo esto con connivencia, obviamente, del Estado, ¿no? De lo cual el Estado, aparte de que le regala el territorio al capital transnacional, pone sus ejércitos mercenarios a proteger esa riqueza de las transnacionales, y lo que ocurre en Colombia es que los fusiles del Estado no apuntan hacia afuera, sino hacia adentro, contra el pueblo mismo, en defensa del interés del capital transnacional.
So, the situation we have at the moment is that all of this is happening with the complicity of the state. It is the state that, first of all, has given the territory to transnational capital. And then it is the state that uses its army, which we call a mercenary army, against its own people in the resistance against this transnational capital.
Es toda una arremetida de todos los frentes que ataca el sistema, porque la lucha es contra el sistema. Entonces, es común los panfletos que amenazan, es común las detenciones arbitrarias, es común los bombardeos, los ametrallamientos. Es muy común en nuestras zonas rurales detenciones masivas, señalamientos por parte de la institucionalidad.
So in the Putumayo region, it's very common that we get a very comprehensive strategy to crush any form of resistance against the system, because ultimately what we are fighting against is a type of system which is inhumane. And it's very common that the army bombards the region. It's very common that from helicopters they shoot down with artillery, with this artillery Huey 33 helicopters that they use. Probably some of you are familiar with them, with the Apocalypse Now, and also Black Hawks and all them. And it's also very common that social leaders are threatened in the public through media, that pamphlets, this kind of small leaflets with death threats are spread around towns with the names of social leaders. It's very common that social leaders get arrested, and it's very common to get mass arrests as well, that over 20 people are arrested in one go.
Bien, en ese sentido, en la región, en el departamento, tenemos alrededor de 60 compañeros y compañeras detenidos por montajes judiciales. Es decir, lo que hace el gobierno es cuando un dirigente sindical, un luchador campesino popular, está, digamos, golpeando muy duro, lo que hacen es hacerle un montaje. Coger a alguien cualquiera, pagarle para que esa persona se haga pasar como desmovilizado de las guerrillas y señalen al compañero. Y solo con ese testimonio condenan a los compañeros nuestros a 30, 40, 50 años.
So,
en las cárceles, obviamente.
Yeah. At the moment we have 60 comrades for our social organizations, 60 of them as political prisoners, just in our region, okay? And the way it usually happens is that you get a leader that becomes prominent, that they mobilize a lot of people, that they start organizing a lot of things, they see who are the heads of a movement, and then what they do is pay someone to pass as an informer. They put them in balaclavas and they said, oh, I belong to the front, whatever, of the guerrillas, and I know that they are supporters, and then they get sentences of 30, 40, and 50 years, just with one testimony done by someone without a face, without a name, without nothing.
Bien, entonces, sin embargo, a pesar de todas esas adversidades, nosotros seguimos de pie, firmes, comprometidos con la causa, porque es necesaria hacerla, la resistencia.
So in spite of all these difficulties, we are still standing strong and we keep going on with this resistance process.
Nuestra región es muy característica porque permanentemente hemos estado en las calles, hemos estado bloqueando las vías, haciendo paros, afectando la economía del capital. Eso nos ha costado como lo dije anterior, compañeros en la cárcel, pero también nos ha costado vidas.
Our region is very strategic because there's oil production there. We have been constantly doing strikes against this aggression, and we can block the roads, and when we block the roads, we stop the flux of capital. So that really hurts them. And at that point is when the repressive apparatus moves in.
El paro más reciente, que significó la pérdida del compañero Arnoldo Muñoz, a quien evocamos desde acá, de alguna otra forma nos llevó a hoy establecer una mesa de diálogo con el gobierno.
In our most recent strike, that was last year, we lost one comrade, Arnoldo Muñoz, who I want to remember now with you. And with that struggle, we managed to get a negotiation going on with the government at the moment.
El paro se hizo porque las fuentes hídricas que abastecen a nuestra gente, los ríos, estaban siendo contaminados por la petrolera Vetra. Entonces, se veía la necesidad de manifestar y de exigir el respeto por las comunidades. Pero además, porque un informe, o mejor, una licencia del Estado, de la ANH, que es la Autoridad Nacional de Hidrocarburos, le había entregado a un consorcio, Colombia Energy y Vetra, para que explote todo lo que es el corredor Puerto Vega Tetelle, alrededor de 12,000 hectáreas, creo que es, de territorio.
So our most recent strike happened because one transaction in particular, Vetra, mentioned in the beginning of the talk, they were contaminating the water sources that are fundamental for our communities. They were throwing all the debris of the oil production, of the oil extraction. I'll explain where se saca compresión. No? It's important to say that the oil is extracted in Colombia through water pressure. So they use the water, it does the pressure, it pumps the oil out, and then it comes out totally contaminated. Okay? And the second reason was because a new concession to this multinational was given by the government of 12,000 hectares, given absolutely free to this multinational for exploitation, without consulting anyone.
Okay. En ese territorio del corredor Puerto Vega Tetelle, municipio de Puerto Asís, Putumayo, se venían explotando alrededor de 36 pozos petroleros. La nueva licencia que otorga el gobierno a este consorcio le daba para explotar más de 100. El rechazo del pueblo organizado fue inminente y era urgente, porque si con explotar 36 pozos estaban causando el impacto ambiental y el daño, no nos podíamos imaginar cuánto iba a causar la explotación de eso. Pero además, el agravante que más enojó al pueblo y que llegó a rebelarse, a levantarse, fue el hecho de que esa licencia desconocía los asentamientos de pueblos originarios y de otros pueblos campesinos y afrodescendientes.
We already had, by the time that this license was given to this multinational, we already had 36 extraction points in all of the, in these sectors called La Vega Tetelle. And this new license was going to increase the number of extraction pumps in over 100. So with 36 of them, we were already getting a very rough deal and a total destruction of the environment. We couldn't imagine what would happen with 100 of them. So eventually, people had to rebel against that. But the rebellion was also propelled by the fact that the license didn't acknowledge that in the area, in the 12,000 hectares given to the multinational, there were indigenous communities. And not only indigenous communities, but also campesino communities, peasant communities. And they were just ignored, they didn't exist.
Bien. En ese sentido, una vez logramos llegar a un acuerdo con el gobierno, resistimos más de 3 meses, digamos, en las vías, en las calles, haciendo el bloqueo al capital transnacional, en este caso a la petrolera, logramos llegar a un acuerdo con el gobierno. Hay que decir que todos estos 3 meses fueron de represión por parte del Estado, que llevó a cobrar la vida del compañero Arnoldo, y después de eso logramos sentarnos a dialogar a partir de septiembre, más o menos, venimos dialogando con el gobierno, finales de agosto.
So, during these 3 months, we started a strike which lasted for 3 months. So, what the strike consisted of, it consisted that the community were all going out to the roads, and they were constantly blockading the transit of oil extracting lorries. So we were blockading the flux of transnational capital. That's what the strike was. You can imagine that around all that time there was heavy repression against us, and that repression cost the life of one of our comrades, Arnoldo. I was mentioning it. Eventually, at the end of August, early September, we managed to get a negotiation commission with the government, and that's the current state in which we are.
Bien. Ahora, ¿qué hemos logrado, digamos, en los diálogos con el gobierno? Primero decir que es difícil porque hay una total indiferencia a dialogar con nosotros, entre otras cosas por lo que estamos pidiendo son cosas estructurales, es decir, la pelea por la tierra, por el territorio, por los derechos fundamentales del pueblo consagrados en la Constitución, que sin embargo es el Estado mismo el que los viola. Entonces, se logra crear 4 comisiones dentro de esos diálogos, una de ellas en el tema la letra.
So, what's the experience of negotiating with the government? It's been very difficult, because basically they have a total indifference against our people. Secondly, because we are demanding structural changes, so it's not something that they can work around very easily. We're talking about the defense of Mother Earth, we're talking about the defense of our territory, and all those things are very uncomfortable for them, because it's all jargon that sounds very beautiful in the Constitution, but it's just not applied in practice, and the state is the first actor not to respect the document that they should be the first one to respect. So out of this negotiation, we've managed to get 4 commissions out. So the first commission is?
La primera comisión? De mineralogía y ambiental.
So we have one commission to debate with them, which is about energy, mining, and extractive policies.
De derechos humanos y la otra.
The other one is of human rights.
De inversión social.
Another one is on social investment. The fourth, I can't remember, but it's all right.
No recuerdo la otra. Sin embargo, lo que se ha logrado es, lo que más se ha avanzado ha sido la Comisión Mineroenergética, que ha logrado que el Estado financie a unos profesionales puestos por nosotros, obviamente, los cuales han hecho todo un trabajo de recolección de muestras, donde se podrá comprobar el estado. En este momento se retoman los diálogos porque hubo un momento hace poquito, digamos, nosotros nos levantamos y anunciamos que íbamos nuevamente a bloquear vías, que es algo que lo que más le preocupa al Estado en Colombia es que el pueblo bloquee vías, que el pueblo paralice el tránsito, digamos, normal del capital.
So, we've managed to achieve something, very little, but something, on the Mining, Extractive and Energy Commission. And how we did that was because we threatened that we were going to start blockading the roads again. And that's really the biggest worry of the government. They don't want any disruption to the flow of capital, to the flow of commodities. So it is our power over the roads which is key. And what we managed with them was that they fund impact assessment studies, but we didn't tell them to send their professionals. We tell them, you fund them, but it is our professionals that will have to do the work, people that we nominate. So that's an agreement already.
Recientemente, digamos, después de todos estos años de diálogo con el gobierno de interlocución, y en vista de que nosotros pues no estamos dispuestos a renunciar a nuestros principios, al compromiso férreo con el pueblo, que son los que de alguna u otra forma están en esta lucha, no por cosas imposibles o por cosas que digamos traídas digamos, descabelladas, que a veces el gobierno quiere hacernos ver de que estamos pidiendo cosas que no, que están salidas del contexto, cuando nosotros, vuelvo y digo, nos basamos a lo constitucional y no salimos de lo constitucional, lo que está establecido en la Carta Magna de Colombia. Sin embargo, el gobierno hace caso omiso a todas las exigencias que pedimos en esa mesa de interlocución.
Yeah, one of the biggest difficulties we're having is that whatever we demand, the government says that it's our crazy demands, they're impossible to realize. And the interesting thing is that we've studied things and we know that everything we are demanding should already be, it's all part of the Constitution. We're not asking for anything that it's that radical, really, but the government find it unacceptable. And what they really found unacceptable is the fact that we have an unbreakable commitment to the welfare of our people.
En esa interlocución, que como les dije anteriormente, estuvo a punto de romperse esos diálogos y que volviéramos a acciones de hecho, logramos con el gobierno continuar dialogando, porque el gobierno inmediatamente lo que hizo fue agilizar el tema de que se había parado el tema de la Comisión Minera Energética. Entonces lo que hicieron ahora fue contratar el laboratorio para que esas pruebas recogidas vayan al laboratorio. Eso es lo más reciente en cuanto a esa comisión. Otra de las comisiones, la que se me olvidaba, es el tema de sustitución de cultivos de uso ilícito. La razón, ustedes deben saber que en Colombia se fumiga con glifosato.
Espera, eso no me lo explicaré después.
Sí.
Okay,
sí, ok,
déjalo ahí, explico la última parte, sigo con esto. Ok, so just to finish one issue. So now they're trying to speed up the negotiations in the Mining Extractive Energy Commission, because obviously that's the one that has more of an economic relevance to them, and they want to go quickly with that. So we already got the samples for the impact assessment study, and now they're paying for the laboratory to do the actual research. And he remembered exactly now the fourth commission, which was the commission for the substitution of illicit crops. And I'll come back to that point now.
Bien. De hecho, una de las razones por la que el pueblo se organiza en un espacio más amplio, que es la mesa regional, fue el tema de la fumigación. A partir del 2006, obviamente la fumigación se venía dando antes, pero a partir del 2006, precisamente por una coyuntura de esas, se da la necesidad de que las organizaciones se articulen para poder hacer, digamos, frente con mayor fuerza a las acciones del gobierno.
Sí, hay que explicar que el tribunal de un departamento de la Cultura Coca también lo puede explicar.
Sí, claro.
Yeah, no, you need a bit of background here. Why a commission on import, on the substitution, sorry, of illicit crops? It's because Putumayo is one of the big producers of coca in Colombia, okay, and therefore in the world. And it's part of the peasant economy. It's one of the very few crops on which people can make some form of a living. And since the 90s, the process of fumigation with glyphosate started, and it accelerated in 2006. So in 2006, a number of people started coming together to oppose to the fumigations, and that's how it all started. Okay, that was the embryo of what we have now.
Bien. El tema de la coca, digamos, ha llevado también a hacer movilizaciones y paros. De una otra forma, el otro mal, digámoslo entre comillas, el otro mal que nos aqueja a nosotros en la región. Pero lo que está comprobado hoy, que a pesar de con la movilización hemos logrado parar la fumigación, ahorita, aunque hace poco se volvió a fumigar, pero se ha logrado parar. Sin embargo, el gobierno está acudiendo a los erradicadores manuales, a la fuerza.
So, the other problem between brackets we have, it's this drug policy and the whole problem around the coca. So, there's been fumigations for a long time, and since the 90s there's been protests against them. And through the protests, we actually managed to stop the fumigation, which is glyphosate, which is highly poisonous. And we've stopped that, but now the government is starting to push the army, military, to do a manual eradication of the coca.
Entonces, lo que decía es que lo que hemos comprobado es que al gobierno colombiano y al gobierno norteamericano no le interesa la coca. Lo que le interesa es el territorio. Nos están fumigando la comida, es decir, la fumigación no es más que una estrategia de desocupación de los territorios para el saqueo del capital transnacional.
So what we've always said is that the Colombian government and the US government, they do not really care that much about the coca. Okay? They're fumigating not just illicit crops, but they're fumigating our livelihoods, they're fumigating our animals, our food crops, and so on and so forth. They're fumigating houses, and what they produce is mass displacement because of this constant poisoning of the communities. And when they displace people, then the multinationals come in to exploit the oil. So it seems that the whole war against drugs is a war against our communities to take us out of our territories.
En ese sentido, lo que se ha hecho, es decir, hay cantidades de denuncias, de demandas. No es solo el atentado con el glifosato a la madre tierra, sino que hay casos de enfermedades en la piel, en nuestra gente. Pero también hay casos de malformaciones en los vientres de las mujeres, precisamente por todos los baños, las lloviznas de glifosato. Todo esto se ha denunciado ante el Estado. Sin embargo, hasta ahorita no se ha reparado a nadie, ni ha pasado nada.
So, this is not just an aggression, this poisoning is not just an aggression against Mother Earth, but it's also, it also has caused a number of skin problems to adults, and it has caused malformations, you say, deformations on babies. Okay, we've denounced that, and there's been no form of justice to the president.
Bien, es por esa razón que nosotros tenemos que acudir a la otra acción, es decir, a las vías de hecho. Siempre agotamos las instancias, a pesar de que la movilización y la protesta está dentro del marco jurídico del gobierno colombiano, aunque hay una norma reciente que lo prohíbe, digamos, que lo criminaliza. Sin embargo, no tenemos otra salida, no tenemos otro camino. Tenemos que exponernos, salir, porque no hay otra forma de resistir, de luchar, de exigir.
This lack of justice is a main problem because we have actually gone through the courts, we've gone through all of the official authorities, and nothing ever happens. And that's why people have to struggle. There's no other way out for us to put our demands forward. There's no other way out for us to demand respect, and even though, and we get a lot of repression, even though supposedly in our very democratic constitution, protest is a social right, but now they passed a decree 2 years ago criminalizing, turning into a criminal offense to stand during a protest on the street. So,
pero bien. Pasando un poco, dejando un poco al lado el tema del petróleo, que es como la ambición ahorita, hay que decir que ahorita hay una recesión por lo de la bajada del barril, del precio del barril, las petroleras dejaron de trabajar, digamos, al ritmo acelerado que traían. Habían más de 500 tractomulas, tractocamiones cargados de petróleo que salían dañando las vías que ellos mismos pavimentaron. Pues obviamente no para beneficio de nosotros, sino para beneficio del capital. Sin embargo, hay otras secuelas u otros daños que ocasiona la explotación petrolera, aparte de lo ambiental y de lo político, en el caso de atacar las organizaciones, es también en lo social.
So now we have a new scenario because the production of oil has come down because of the recession, because of
fall of oil prices.
Yeah, the prices have come down. So they're not exploiting to the same intensity that they used to. Before that, we had constantly in our region 500 lorries going up and down our roads and damaging them, which was a public good for their own private interest. Okay, and I want to emphasize that the oil extraction is not only damaging in environmental terms and in political terms because of these attacks on dissent, but also socially.
Como socialmente. Lo social, es decir, se genera prostitución, por ejemplo. alrededor de los grandes los grandes jefes de la empresa petrolera, se ve mucho eso, generó prostitución. Se vende la idea ante la gente del país del centro de que el boom petrolero genera empleo y llega mucha gente de otras regiones. Cuando se estrellan con la realidad, es falso de que el petróleo genere empleo, genere progreso, al menos no para los pueblos. Entonces se dedican a delinquir. Entonces hay más delincuencia en la región, más delincuencia organizada, precisamente creyendo que había desarrollo, que habría riqueza, y se dan cuenta de que no hay ningún tipo de beneficio.
Yeah, so oil production brings also a generalized meltdown of our own communities, of society, because you have all of a sudden this economic boom. People believe, because it is a myth, that when you have oil exploitation, there's going to be jobs and there's going to be money flowing and all that, and it doesn't happen. And people from different regions come escaping poverty to our own communities. They arrive there, they find no jobs, and then you get an increase in crime, prostitution, and all sort of other social problems.
Pero además, algo que nos duele mucho porque pues somos hermanos, es que las petroleras también nos han puesto a pelear entre pueblos originarios, a pelear entre campesinos e indígenas, a pelear entre afros, negros y así. Es decir, nos han puesto a pelear porque tienen muy buenos profesionales que hacen todo un trabajo psicológico con nuestra gente que quizá no tiene de pronto la capacidad de asimilar muchas cosas, que se deja impresionar por el recurso, por el dinero y por toda la estrategia de engañar.
So yeah, another big deep problem that's very hurtful for us is that they create a lot of internal conflict within the communities. So these multinationals come here and they play the black Colombians against the peasants against the indigenous against the other indigenous, and everyone is in a war against one another after productive projects and social investment and whatever money is given to social leaders. And sometimes our people do not have all the understanding of this strategy behind, because they have professionals that work psychologically and socially on this, and they just get very impressed when they see a flash of money.
Bien, pero les decía que sí, dejando un poco el tema del petróleo, hay algo en el momento que nos preocupa y que de alguna u otra forma el llamado también es a todos, es decir, a la humanidad, al planeta, es el tema del agua. Putumayo es muy rico en agua dulce. Hay una variedad de ríos, en su gran mayoría todos sanos, con agua cristalina, deliciosa, para bañarse, para tomar.
So another issue that concerns us a lot and we want to make it very clear here is the fact that we have a huge problem with water now. Okay, water is a very valuable resource, and Putumayo is one of the most, one of the richest areas in terms of freshwater sources. We have loads of them, and we have a very still largely pure freshwater sources in our region.
En ese sentido, la lucha del agua, de hecho, los gobiernos locales al servicio del capital. Vienen privatizando en algunos municipios el agua, que era del pueblo organizado, servicios, digamos, públicos, vienen siendo privatizados para beneficio y acomodo de unas cuantas familias de cada municipio. Pero además sabemos que hay proyectos de interés en montar hidroeléctricas en ríos tan importantes para nosotros como el río Mocoa, los que quedan por la cuenca alta del río Mocoa.
So, yeah, tengo que ir un poco de también sobre el tema de la privatización del agua. So we are having a huge problem now with the privatization of water. So the way it's happened is that most of the infrastructure in those communities of Colombia has been built by the people themselves. So originally a lot of the water services were created by the communities without any state funding. They've been done just by the people themselves. Then at some point the state came in and turned them into public. Okay, so they turned them into public and now they're handing them back to privates. So that's the way it's come a full circle now, not a circle, an open triangle, however you want to put it in geological terms. But the other problem is that they're starting to build dams. and that's very damaging as well. And there's a number of rivers coming out of the Mocoa River in the highlands of Putumayo, and they're planning to put dams just there, and that would be disastrous.
Sin embargo, quiero señalar una resistencia que viene haciendo los pueblos originarios del Alto Putumayo, los pueblos Inga, que por tercera vez le dijeron no a la Anglo-Golachanti, que está interesada y a la cual el gobierno le ha logrado dar las concesiones y las licencias para explotar oro en esa cuenca alta del río Mocoa, que sería garrafal, sería desastroso de que lograran explotar eso. La ventaja, dale.
Dams usually go hand in hand with mining exploitation. And in that part of Mocoa, the highlands of Putumayo, there's gold. And Anglo Gold Ashanti, it's a famous mining transnational, they've been opposed by the local indigenous communities in the highlands of Putumayo, and the resistance has been successful. They've kept the multinational so far out of the territory.
Bien. Entonces, finalmente, Putumayo también está perjudicado, digamos, porque forma parte, en el marco de la globalización del hambre, de la miseria que plantea el sistema capitalista, formamos parte de los famosos megaproyectos que buscan conectar a toda América Latina con el mundo. A nosotros nos atraviesa la marginal de la selva y nos atraviesa el corredor multimodal Tumaco-Belén-Dopará, que busca conectar el Pacífico con el Atlántico, y lo cual implica que canalizarían el río Putumayo.
Uh-huh. So, again, coming back to the water sources, we are strategically located, unfortunately, in something that the globalization of the capitalist system calls a strategic mega project zone. So Putumayo, it is crossed by one river that they want to join the Pacific with the Atlantic coast. So they're going to change the whole hydric system, and they're going to build something like the Panama Canal, but like really massive, going through the middle of the Amazon. And that's the big project now that we have to resist.
Bien, simplemente, compas, decirles que hoy más que nunca se hace necesario estrechar lazos de hermandad, de fraternidad, de camaradería, si se quiere. Es decir, está en riesgo la vida de la humanidad. Ya no es la pelea por el país, ya no es la pelea por la región, es la pelea por la humanidad. El sistema capitalista nos ha declarado la guerra a la humanidad, no a un solo pueblo. Hoy más que nunca se hace necesario la unidad para poder derrocar al maldito sistema.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to finish now by saying that all of this just gives you a sense of how urgent our struggle is. This is the Amazon, the lungs of the world, as they call it. And this is a struggle to defend life. It's not about the defense of our communities alone. It's not about the defense of our country. It's the defense of life, and it's the defense of humanity. It's the defense of Mother Earth. The capitalist system has declared war not just against one particular community. It's declared war against the whole of the humanity. Right. And that's why it's important, the unity of all the people all over the world, in order to be able to finally topple this accursed system. And that's how I'm finishing. So, yeah.
Okay, so while we move on to the Q&A, Barry, who's standing at the back there, is going to be handing out some feedback forms, and we're going to take three contributions at a time. We've got about 20 minutes for contributions from the floor, so if you can see a show of hands, I'll take the first three I see. Yeah.
Solidarity. It's an Irish and Colombian group of solidarity. So this is more a contribution than a question. So I just wanted to let you know, as you probably know, that we work with communities in Colombia. We have been campaigning with different issues, such as the signature of the free trade agreement between the EU and Colombia, that, as you probably know, was approved by the Irish Parliament last January. But we lost in the fact that it was approved, but we actually had a very good victory because a lot of parliamentarians vote against that agreement. So that's one of the campaigns we have been involved, and we have also been supporting local communities in Colombia, such as the community in Putumayo, Valle del Cauca, and Tolima. Our work is based in communities that do not make it to the media, nobody about issues that are not heard about. And something that I would like to say is that we don't get any funding from anyone. And I think that that's key for what Fabio was saying, that in many cases the communities are have suffered the impact of projects that are founded by people that have interest there. So we don't get any funding from anyone. We don't have any economic interest in anything. We don't work with any, we're not part of any bigger NGO or anything like that. We would like to invite you to join us. We meet regularly in Dublin, and you are more than welcome to join us and support the struggle of the people in Putumayo and the struggle of the people in Colombia and other places. And there are other people here from the group, so I don't know if I'm missing something, but if I'm missing something, please join me.
I wanted to ask you a few years ago in Colombia, there was this consultation for the water. It was to do with this idea of having the human rights in the having a referendum to introduce water as a human right. Remember a few years ago? It was like a consultation. It was like maybe 6-7 years ago that they wanted to introduce, you remember that they wanted to make water as a human right, and they were doing all this referendum, but finally they didn't do that. My question to you is that I suppose water is a human right, but at the moment it seems that they want to privatize it in Colombia, they are already privatizing it here. Does it mean that, do you think that you can learn something from your experience? I know a friend of us called Valeria Llano, she did some research about how people in Colombia were mobilizing themselves to have water, to recognize water as a human right. I think it was in the constitution, I can't remember very well. But maybe, I think that was kind of at least people mobilizing, I don't know what happened at the end, but people were collecting signatures because they wanted to have water as a human right in the constitution, I think.
Okay, so take one more, and then we'll come back to the speaker. Tom, you were.
What's the relationship like between the people of Putumayo and the wider struggles in Colombia? Have you much support from groups in the city? I just want to say as well that what you're saying is exactly right. The Zapatistas in Mexico talk a lot about a fourth world war that we're living through at the moment, a war for humanity against capitalism. And I think that's exactly right.
Bien, pues lo del referendo, obviamente que no prosperó, ¿no? Y lo ideal sería luchar, dar la pelea, pero es muy difícil dentro del sistema lograr cosas porque, como lo decía hace rato, todo lo que el gobierno tiene es él el que lo viola y lo manipula a su antojo.
So on the referendum, yeah, it's quite obvious that at this stage the referendum strategy failed. The referendum never took place. It would be very good to keep pushing that, but the difficulty is that if it's not true, if it's true that, let's say, constitutional means, it's very difficult to do any struggle because the government controls everything and they do not respect any of these popular initiatives.
En ese sentido, claro, tenemos que ver cómo logramos los pueblos unir esfuerzos. Yo creo que el tema del agua es un tema que debe unir a los pueblos del mundo. Y quizá vamos a lograr de alguna u otra forma, si logramos articular muchos procesos poder avanzar en algo en la defensa del agua.
So yes, I do agree that the struggle for water is a struggle that should bring together all the people of the world today to defend. And if we come together and if we struggle and if we pressure together, we're going to be able to achieve far more than us nationally.
Sí. Okay. Sí, nosotros en Putumayo formamos parte, digamos, las organizaciones de base forman parte de plataformas de nivel nacional.
So, in Putumayo, we are members of different national platforms, different national networks we are part of.
De hecho, el paro que de alguna otra forma desestabilizó algo, bueno, no hablemos de desestabilizar, pero sí lo puso a pensar, porque creo que ustedes fueron testigos de que Santos, en el marco del paro, ordenó mover más de 40.000 efectivos a Bogotá porque tenía miedo, pensó que cuando la solidaridad de los centros urbanos, cuando el cacerolazo en Bogotá, que salieron de muchas partes a concentrarse, simplemente era gente que estaba solidarizándose, mas no tenía la mínima intención de derrocar al gobierno. Pero logramos, precisamente porque estamos articulados, logramos paralizar más de 23 departamentos, es decir, más de la mitad del país se paralizó con la fuerza, el sentir y la organización del campesino.
In Colombia, 2 years ago, through these national platforms, we managed to have a national strike that took place in 23 departments of Colombia. So Colombia has 32 departments, so that means that over a half of the country went on a general strike that was propelled by the struggle of the peasant and the rural communities. The people in urban centers, for the first time in history, came out to support the peasant demands, and even though they were not interested in toppling the government, still the government ordered that 40,000 soldiers came to Bogotá, to the capital, to militarize the big city. That was 2 years ago.
Sí.
So, yeah, summer 2013.
Okay, got any more questions or contributions? Anywhere? No?
Okay, so okay. There's someone there.
Oh. Where?
So what is your vision for the future? It's like, what do you hope for?
Gracias.
Thank you.
No, yo creo que estamos convencidos, ¿no?, de que vamos a cambiar esto. O sea, nosotros estamos aquí porque sabemos que es aquí donde debemos estar. Es decir, no estamos equivocados. Otro mundo es posible y estamos llenos de sueños, de esperanzas. Eso que el maldito sistema quiere acabar, los sueños, el sentir y el querer, nosotros estamos llenos de eso.
So, I've no doubt that we will manage to change this. There's not a doubt of that. And we are doing this because we know we are right, and we couldn't be doing anything else. The system tries to convince us that dreaming, that having aspirations, that having the alternative visions of what society would be, it's wrong. But they have faith with us because we're actually all full of that.
Okay.
Just to add here, I'm also part of that group that works with different groups in Colombia as well. I just wanted to let you know that we will be outside if some people are interested.
Oh, we have a stall, yeah.
And wants to come and talk to us. And also that on the 28th of April, which is Tuesday?
Tuesday.
We will have as well another activity. We will be in Peer Center, and we will have the kind of a talk with the Roger Casement and his struggle for the rights of the Putumayo and Indians 100 years old, and we will have again our partner Fabio talking there and with other people. And if you are interested, we're all very welcome. So just to say that.
No, about that one, the other person that will be there is Angus Mitchell. He wrote a book on Roger Casement, and they're going to be assessing the impact of of the Roger Caseman report on the Putumayo Indians back then and what's the situation now, 100 years later. So if you're interested in that, we'll be able to go to the Peer Center on Tuesday.
It's like, is Roger Caseman remembered in Putumayo?
No.
No.
Es triste, pero no.
Yeah.
No, it's sad, but no. No, it's not remembered.
Yeah.
Well, actually, it's interesting. Voy a explicar un poco la situación. What's interesting is that with a lot of the communities that he worked at the time, then they were absolutely annihilated. I mean, a lot of the indigenous communities that Roger Caseman worked with, people can't remember him because the people that could have an oral tradition of that actually disappeared. They were obliterated. And that all came through the different extractive phases of the advancement of capitalism in Putumayo. The indigenous communities, you have that. There are offsprings of resistance in many ways. And there's also people that came, that became settlers, peasants, and they become part as well of these of this regional culture and got adapted to it. And they're resisting now, same as other indigenous communities resisted 100 years. So even though sometimes there's no direct memory of Caseman, there is a very direct memory about that tradition of struggle and resistance. It's not like, yeah, the poor Indians were there and they were waiting for a white man to go there and say, look how much they suffer. I mean, they were resisting and struggling, and that keeps going on.
I just forgot something important about the ILO convention, you know, the United Nations ILO convention, with the whole idea of the indigenous people. Do you think that type of, because as far as I know, Ireland as a country has not ratified the ILO convention, and this applies as well for the working rights. Do you think that this would make any difference if countries in Europe would ratify this ILO convention from the UN in terms of the situation for indigenous people and the whole issue of the workers' rights and you know, with the whole mining thing as well, if you have the ILO convention ratified, which means that you will need to have consultations. Because I know, for example, in Guatemala, where they tried to build the mining company, I mean, with the whole ILO convention, they have to, I suppose, have this kind of consultation with the community, and the same period with me. I don't know, as far as I know, whether that makes any difference to have this.
Los pueblos originarios de nuestra región acuden a esa norma internacional, pero para el gobierno colombiano no respeta nada. Es decir, eso es lo mismo que nada. Entonces, vuelvo y digo, o sea, acuden a eso y hay cantidades de demandas que te puedas imaginar en los estrados de las Cortes de Colombia, pero ninguna ha prosperado.
So, yeah, in Colombia we have the 169 convention of the ILO approved. And people actually regularly use that convention and demand consultation, and then consultation happens, people reject, and then the government totally ignores that. Okay? So then what people do is go to tribunals, and then the case is sitting there in the tribunals for years and nothing happens. And we've had hundreds, if not thousands, of cases in the tribunals today, and nothing has ever happened. So all those regulations per se are basically useless on their own.
Well, I think we're going to bring this meeting to a close.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Prometo que se va a conocer más de Caseman en Putumayo.
Can you repeat where the meeting on Tuesday evening is to be held?
It's a peer center.
Peer
center. So it's going to be 27 Pierce Street, the peer center, and it's going to be at 6 p.m. So Angus Mitchell will be there. He'll bring books as well about Roger Caseman. So those of you who got a liking for reading today, you'll be pleased to know, and we'll discuss about Putumayo.
28, Tuesday 28, 20, not 27.
Tuesday at 28, sorry, no, but I said 27 Pierce Street.
Okay.
I was giving the address, not the date.
All right. So thanks everybody for coming, and thanks for the...